this. He's king of all days.
Boxes of importance, other boxes of opportunity, the tell a child about God's love about his son, Jesus Christ.
If you get the heart of the child, he will reach the heart of the parents, will reach the heart of the family, and then he will touch the community. That gift box is the beginning into their hearts.
Isn't it incredible how these gifts touch the lives of these children? Every year we see tens of thousands of children disciple. And we couldn't do this without you. So thank you for packing the boxes. Thank you for praying for these children around the world. God bless you and keep packing those boxes.
I asked them if they would come up and just be a good example. They have been very excited about finding just the right things to put into the boxes and even talking about what a good feeling it is to take the time to do this. We talked today about two purposes to these boxes. One is these boxes are going around the world to children who probably have never had a gift. And so the first thing is they're opening the box and they're knowing that somebody cared enough about them to take the time to pack a gift. But through getting that gift, they also get the greatest gift. They get a chance to hear the gospel and hear about Jesus. And then if they so choose, they get a chance to go through a discipleship course so that they can learn more about God. And so there's really nothing bad about doing this. It does make you feel really good, I would agree. I went to a leadership group a few weeks ago, and just a couple little tips I wanted to share was how important it is to send school supplies. And we kind of learned about this in VBS this summer even, that in many countries, you cannot go to school if you don't have school supplies, and parents often have to make choices between food and medicine and school supplies. And so, for your kids, be sure you're packing school supplies. Something that really touched my heart that I learned was they were talking about the importance of putting a good quality eraser in the shoebox, because what children often do is they fill their notebook and then they have to go back and erase so that they can use that same notebook again, because that's the only paper they have. And so something as tiny as an eraser can be so important. Toothbrushes, washcloths, we talked about, especially in orphanages, children don't have those things, or they may have to share. And so getting your own toothbrush and your own washcloth, things like that, can be very, very special. So, pray about how many boxes God would like you to pack. There is an online option. It mentions it in this brochure. When you pack a box online, those boxes are going to countries that they have to be super careful about what goes there. So you kind of choose the types of items, but Samaritan's Purse knows, okay, we can only put this kind of doll, for instance, in, or these kinds of objects. So, that's a great option too, and that's one of the reasons of doing the online option. I did open our account, so it's Memorial Baptist Church, New Haven, Mo. Our goal is, last year I believe we packed 97 boxes, so we'd like to get that with 100 this year. We are on target in my class to pack at least 10. And what we've done in the past is, if you buy a package of washcloths and you have a few extras, feel free to give us items and we'll just keep packing boxes as long as we can. This is a very special time of year, and like I said, you guys all smile. You got some great people here ready to go to work. We'd love you to pack your own box, but we will be happy to help out too. If you have any questions, please let me know, and 5 weeks from today is when I will take the boxes. So we got
five weeks notice. Thank you. Julie, thank you. Now the children can go to church.
Thank you. Well, Wednesday night, I had a short prayer time for Israel. I felt compelled to do that again this morning because it's a burden that's on my heart right now. I also thought of the Lord what was taking place. And just the, I'm going to say it's demonic, but the barbaric genocidal brutality, the Palestinian portion known as the Hamas is terrible. And it grieves me to hear, I can't look at the images, but I can hear it, and it just grieves me to see what's going on and think about those people. And that's God's chosen people, that's Israel. And I feel much of the reason why God has blessed America is because we have stood behind Israel. I'm hoping that what we're seeing taking place today is real with our current administration, but it appears that we are still doing that. And if you go in, God says in the Abrahamic covenant that he will bless those who bless Israel, and then he will curse those who curse Israel. And so I want to be on the blessing side, and I want that for our nation and for each of us. So, God's eternal purpose, I believe, from reading scripture is that he's going to bless the world through Israel. And a lot of that's the most important part right now in this life has already happened. Jesus Christ, our Savior, is a Jew. He came through the Jews. Our Bible is Jewish. I'm pointing to my iPad because my Bible's in there, but you know what I mean. And so he already has, but there's more to come. You can read about that. Just go to Isaiah chapter 27. But it's a time, we're in an interesting time right now in history. And I think if you just read Ezekiel, start reading Ezekiel 38, 39, go back to Daniel chapter 11, I think it is. It's unfolding. God's word is divine. It's happening. And so we already know what's going to happen. Okay, it's just a matter of time. And so I want to pray right now for Israel. I ask you to bow your heads and pray with me because I want him to bless us as a church family. I want him to continue to bless us as a nation. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for who you are. I thank you that you're in control of all things. And even right now with all of what's taking place, I know that you are in control of this, and this is part of your plan. I thank you for telling us in your word that we are to bless Israel. And so right now, in a small way, I want to be able to do that for me and my church family. Father, I just want to start right now by saying, I ask for you to watch over those that are being held captive right now. I know even those folks in Gaza that are not part of this, that are being held captive, but Lord, the Israelites that are there right now and being held hostage, I want to pray for them. Some of those are even American citizens probably, and so I just want to pray for them. Pray that you protect them in what's going on, just give them a peace. I pray that you would release them from their captivity. Father, that goes universally. Release all these people from their captivity, even our enemies, the Hamas, they can be changed. I know that you can do that. And it's hard for me to pray that. But I ask that you either convert them or eliminate them. That's what I pray for. Father, for all of those in that region that have been affected, certainly spiritually, but physically, everybody that's been wounded and traumatized, I pray for peace and comfort there, Lord. I pray for the leadership of Israel, Father, that they can understand the times and know what to do. My prayer for them is to know how to win this war the right way and quickly and get it over. And so that's my way of blessing Israel today. Please take that. Thank you for loving us so much and allowing us to still have freedoms that we have this morning to come and worship you and feel safe. Your love is so amazing. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with me? Sing this. Amazing love.
Oh.
How many know that for a fact?
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for sending with me. Pastor Pat, I am just dying to hear the message. I've missed it the last, 2 weeks, and so I'm excited. We're ready for you. Thank you all for sending.
Fundamental nature of something necessary to make that what it is. Essential. I want to share with you 7 essential characteristics of a healthy church. A church that can flourish. Healthy means normal physical and mental vigor, and freedom from disease, weakness, and disorder. Means to have good color, vitality, strength, soundness, good heart rate, good pulse rate. Everyone loves to hear when the doctor says, you have good vitals and you're very healthy. And so I want to share with you the importance of a healthy church. My text is Matthew chapter 16, verse 13 through 20, and then Ephesians 5. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah and one of the prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he strictly charged the disciples that no one tell that he was the Christ. And then in Ephesians 5, verse 25 through 27, we read, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. The church, the body of Christ, the people of God, the temple of the Holy Spirit, the called out ones, you, brothers and sisters, represent the body of Christ. The church is a living, vital organism. It has our organization, but it's first of all a living, vital organism. And I want to share with you what I believe are some 7 principles to help a church understand what it means to be healthy and to be flourishing under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. So first, let's consider this. A healthy church is marked with a celebrative worship service. Amen. A celebrative worship service. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I know you know this, but one of the things that we're going to do throughout heaven is worship the living God revealed in Jesus Christ. Christ. Amen? And so we're getting in practice down here. And we need to have a worship experience and to celebrate that we lift our hearts and our minds to the living God. Ralph Martin, in his book, The Worship of God, wrote, "Worship is a dramatic celebration of God in His supreme worth in such a manner that His worthiness becomes the norm and inspiration for living." Do you realize that when God created Adam and Eve, their first priority was to worship Him? And I want all of us to understand something. Our priority, our number one priority as believers in Jesus Christ, as Christians, is to worship the living God revealed in Jesus Christ in song, praise, adoration.
Yes.
We're here to worship God. And we need to have a sense of celebration about it. It needs to be joy. I'm so glad that Baptists are getting much better in this. You know, I told my church, I said, I'm a Bapticostal. I like a little bit of joy and praise and worship so that your hearts and your lives are in it. Jesus said that God is spirit and those that worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. John 4:24. We're to worship from our heart, from our spirit, from our inner being as we come and lift our lives and our hearts in song and praise and adoration. This is what God is seeking. That's what it says in John 4:23, that God is seeking for those to worship Him. Only twice in the Bible does it mention the word seeking. And it talks about God seeking to save those who are lost. Coming down and get my water. Get no more sinus infection. So, bear with me. My voice cracks. That's a problem of having a sinus infection. But we are to worship God and to love Him with all our heart. Listen to Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise Him with the harp and lyre. Praise Him with the tambourine and dancing. Now Baptists usually skip over that verse. Praise Him with the strings and flute. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So worship is so important. Ronald Allen wrote, "Worship is an active response to God, whereby we declare His worth." John MacArthur wrote, "The nature of worship then is to offer God worship from the depths of our inner beings in praise, prayer, song, giving, and living, always based upon His revealed truth. The person who would worship God must therefore have a faithful commitment to the Word of God. Worship does not happen by a zap out of heaven that makes us fall down. It is the overflow of our understanding of God as He reveals Himself in Scripture. That is worshiping in spirit and in truth."
Yes.
Brothers and sisters, I want to say this again. Your highest priority as a believer in Jesus Christ is to worship God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your being, all that you are. We're together. Wow, if you ever just turn over to Revelation 4 and 5, both chapters are just filled with worship. I'll just read a few verses. "And all the elders fell down, and all they began to say, 'Worthy are you to take the seal, to open the scroll, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people people for God, from every tribe and nation people. And you made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. Then I looked and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders, the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth, wisdom, might, and honor, and glory, and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and the sea and all that's in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. So a healthy church is one that worships the Lord, celebrating praise, admonition, and lifts up their lives and voice in song and praise to him. Second, a healthy church is marked with a biblically based preaching and teaching ministry.
Amen.
The center of a church needs to be the precious word of God. Amen? This word right here. Thank God, when I was saved, I made a commitment to God. I said, "I'll believe it from Genesis to Revelation, every word of it. I believe it is inerrant, God-breathed, inspired, fully God's word of divine nature. It is the foundation of our life." Amen?
Amen.
We build everything that we believe upon this word. And that's why the word of God must be proclaimed in the pulpit. In 2 Timothy 4, we read, "In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of their appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, exhort with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine." It's here right now. They're moving away from the truth of the word of God. They're moving away from the supernatural work of God. There are those that will mock the word of God and the supernatural events that took place. I believe when the Bible said God split the Red Sea and two men went through it, I believe every bit of it. And I believe that when the Egyptians came through, then God covered them up, just like the word of God says. I heard a liberal professor who mocked and laughed and said it was only 2 feet deep. And one student yelled out, "Praise God, what a miracle. He drowned all the Egyptians in 2 feet of water." I like that. It says in 2 Timothy, all scripture is theopneustos, God breathed, and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. The Bible is the word of God. I know that you're looking for a new pastor, and I've already been here long enough to know that you will only have a pastor who believes this word to be God's word. From Genesis to Revelation. I don't have any doubt about that. I know your committee. I know your members. And they are committed to the word of God as truth, and that it is to be proclaimed and preached from this pulpit.
Amen. Yes.
And I say amen. I think I'll make it through before I lose my voice. You know, when Jesus said, "Who they say that I am," Peter said, "Thou art the Christ, Messiah, the one that was promised to come, the Son of the living God." And I believe that's the rock, that profession, that confession. That is the confession that we make in this church and every true church, it stands on the fact that Jesus Christ is the eternal Son of the living God, the Messiah, the Lord of heaven and earth, and praise God, He saves all who will trust Him with their life and receive Him as Lord and Savior. Number three, a healthy church is marked with a solid leadership foundation. A solid leadership foundation. John Maxwell is probably the premier, absolute premier teacher of leadership. I remember the first conference that I went with him, I was overwhelmed by his knowledge of leadership. And one of the things he said, you can summarize leadership in one word. One word. Leadership is influence. He said, when you can influence God's people to love the Word, to love Him, and to serve Him, and to worship Him, and to charge their hearts to carry out His will and commission for the church, that is the influence of leadership that is so valuable. Every church needs leadership from the top all the way down. I had the privilege of pastoring 40 years at Ridgecrest Baptist Church in St. Charles, Missouri. And I remembered when I retired at 68 years of age. That was just a year ago. Just kidding. I remember leading that church with a heart just full of joy for this reason. I knew that that church had a foundation of leadership, and that the deacon body had been trained in the leadership, and that the committees and all the structure was solid. They went several years before they got a pastor, and they are still flourishing for the Lord. Thank God for good leadership. And Jesus Christ is the model of leadership. John Maxwell, and I just touch on these, said there's 21 irrefutable laws of leadership. He called it, first, the law of the lid. Leadership determines the level of effectiveness. Number two, the law of influence. True measure of leadership is influence. Nothing more, nothing less. The law of process. Leadership develops daily, not in a day. The law of navigation. Anyone can steer the ship, but it takes a leader to chart the course. The law of E.F. Hutton. When the real leader speaks, people listen. The law of solid ground. Trust is the foundation of leadership.
Yes.
The law of respect. People naturally follow leaders stronger than themselves.
Yes.
The law of intuition. Leaders evaluate everything through a leadership bias. The law of magnetism. Who you are is who you attract. The law of connection. Leaders touch a heart before they ask for a hand. The law of the inner circle, leader is potential. Leader's potential is determined by those closest to him. The law of empowerment, our secure leaders give power to others. Law of reproduction, it takes a leader to raise up leaders. The law of buy-in, people buy into the leader, then they buy into the vision. 15, the law of victory. Leaders find a way for the team to succeed.
Yes.
Number 16, the law of the big meter. Momentum is leader's best friend. The law of sacrifice. Leaders must give up to go up.
Amen.
The law of priorities. Leaders understand that activity is not necessarily accomplishment.
Amen.
The law of timing. When to lead is important as what to do and where to go. And then the law of explosive growth. To add growth, lead followers, and to multiply, lead leaders. And finally, The law of legacy, a leader's lasting value is measured by succession. Leroy Allen said, a leader is one who sees more than others see, who sees farther than others see, and who sees before others do. John Maxwell, I say, close this thought. Everything rises and falls on leadership.
Amen.
May God grant that your church will develop leaders, and I know you are right now, and continue and have a man that will lead you in carrying out God's purpose for this church.
Amen.
Number four, a healthy church is marked with an effective prayer ministry.
Yes, Lord.
Now I know that everybody here this morning believes in prayer. A Christian knows that prayer is possible and that prayer changes things, and it also changes us. In Acts 4, when they were witnessing for Christ and they were persecuted, they went back and joined together and began to pray. And verse 31 said, after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. Prayer is so important to our personal life and for the life of the church. I cannot say this enough, that until the church really gets serious about prayer and praying, they will never feel the impact that God can bring upon the people in that fellowship and that church. In his book, Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire, Jim Cimbala, who was pastor of the Brooklyn Tabernacle, and they just saw incredible things happen, had a daughter, Chrissy, who became a rebel. And I mean, when we say rebel, she turned into a rebel. And so he began to tell the church, we've got to pray. And he prayed for everything, but he shared with them that particular need about his daughter. And they began an intensive prayer for her. And this is recorded in his book. He said after they had a prayer time of intensive prayer, 32 hours later, on Thursday morning, I was shaving. Carol, his wife, suddenly burst through the door, her eyes wide. Go downstairs, she blurted. Chrissy's here. Chrissy's here. Yes, go down. But Carol, I just go down, she urged. It's you. She wants to see you. I wiped off my shaving foam, headed down the stairs, my heart pounding. As I came around the corner, I saw my daughter on the kitchen floor, rocking on her hands, knees, sobbing. Cautiously, I spoke her name. Thank you. Chrissy. She grabbed my pant leg and began pouring out anguish. Daddy, Daddy, I've sinned against God. I've sinned against myself. I've sinned against you and Mommy. Please forgive me. My vision was clouded by my tears, as hers was. I pulled her up from the floor, held her close to me, and we cried together. Suddenly, she drew back. Daddy, she said with a start, who was praying for me? Who was praying for me? Her voice was like that of a cross-examining attorney. What do you mean, Chrissy? On Tuesday night, by the way, that was the night they began to pray. Dad, who was praying for me? I didn't say anything. So she continued. In the middle of the night, God woke me up and showed me I was heading toward the abyss. There was no bottom to it. It scared me to death. I was so frightened. I realized how hard I've been, how wrong, how rebellious. But But at the same time, it was like God wrapping his arms around me, and he held me tight. He kept me from sliding further. And he said, I still love you. Daddy, tell me the truth. Who was praying for me Tuesday night? I looked into her bloodshot eyes, and once again, I recognized the daughter we had raised. Chrissy returned to the Lord and became evident immediately. By that fall, God had opened a miraculous door for her to enroll at a Bible college, where she not only undertook studies, but soon began directing music groups and a large choir just like her mother. Today, she is a pastor's wife in the Midwest with three wonderful children. Through all of this, Carol and I learned as never before that persistent calling upon the Lord breaks through every stronghold of the devil. Nothing is impossible for God. Amen?
Amen.
For Christians in these troubled times, there is simply no other way. You know, when I read that, wow, my heart was so deeply moved, and I'm going to tell you why. My son David was saved at the age of 7. He was called into the ministry. He went to Southwest Baptist University in Bolivar, Missouri, a good Baptist college. But while he was there, he decided to do some reading on his own in theology, and unfortunately, he got the wrong book, Rudolf Bultmann. Now, you may not know him, but I can just tell you this. He wasn't a Christian. He was not a believer. He didn't believe in the incarnation. But he was brilliant, and he taught in a seminary. And my son got confused, totally confused. And all of a sudden, he came home, and I'll never forget. He walked into the house, his hair was down here, he had a scowl on his face. And I thought, what in the world has happened? And he said, Dad, I'm not a Christian and I don't believe anything anymore. I don't even believe there's a God. You talk about shock. You talk about being knocked back. I was overwhelmed. I couldn't believe it. My wife and I were just heartbroken. And no matter what we would say, it didn't seem to do any good. So we did what we should always do in the first place. We started praying. And we prayed intensely. And I remember, I'll never forget this, folks. I mean, you talk about the hand of God, the providence of God. I'm going to tell you, when I tell you how this developed, if you don't raise your hand and say, praise God, I'm just going to walk out. I'm just kidding. One day I was praying intensely, and God said, I want you. My son had already graduated from college, and he was in the living room just playing his guitar, singing, wouldn't work. I mean, everything just went whack. And he said, I want you to go in and tell your son that you'll take him to Colorado, San Gabriel, the Crystal Mountains, where there's a seminary up there, if he'd like to go. And I really thought, I obviously heard God wrong. Because I said, Lord, am I hearing you right? Now, I didn't hear him audibly, but in my mind and my heart, it was so clear. There's a seminary up there. My wife and I had been up to a Christian camp up there. And it's very primitive, but they're conservative. And they teach the truth. And God said, just obey me. So I said, okay. So I walked into the living room and I said, David, how would you like to go to Colorado and go up San Gabriel to Crystal Mountains to a seminary? He looked up and said, hey, Dad, let's do it. It's like God said, what do you think of that? So we got into the car, and we drove out there. We didn't talk much about theology. God just said, just let me handle this. We got there, and it was very primitive, and he loved it. And we were there for a while, and then I left. What they did, it was a seminar where professors would come in for maybe a 3-week or 4-week course from other seminaries, and teach, and then go back home, and then have another one come in. About a month later, I got a phone call. Said, hello. It was my son. And he said, Dad, folks, I can tell you by the sound of his voice, I knew something had changed. And he said, Dad, I know I'm a Christian.
Amen.
I know I'm saved.
Amen.
He said, I was totally wrong. And I said, wow, what happened? What brought this about? He said, the first course I took, a professor from Covenant Seminary, which is a conservative Presbyterian professor, came up and taught a month on the false teaching of Rudolf Bultmann. Hallelujah! I mean, are you kidding? That first course was on Rudolf Bultmann and the error of all his teaching. And God turned his heart. And now he's in a full-time Christian ministry.
Amen.
Don't ever underestimate the power of prayer.
Yes.
Number five, a healthy church is marked with a loving, caring fellowship. John 13, 34 to 35, Jesus said, a new commandment I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this all men will know that you're my disciples, if you love one another. They said of the early church, my, how they love one another. It is so important that God's people who are saved and redeemed in the body of Christ love one another. One of the greatest tactics Satan will bring to a church is to divide the fellowship and get them arguing, fighting among one another. That's why old churches have gone through some heartaches. Our church did in 1988, and there was a division. 110 people left. Satan will do everything he can. And since then, I said we need to pray even stronger for our fellowship. And praise God, things turned. The church began to grow again. We relocated the church. God blessed the church. It's flourishing. But folks, it is so important that you love one another.
Amen.
Notice what it said. A new command I give you, that you love one another just as I loved you. Also, you're to love one another. By this, all men, all people will know that you're my disciples if you love one another. Not if we have a knowledge of the scripture, and I believe in that, we should. That's good. Not if we have the ability to win Christ, people to Christ, and we should do that. And that's our responsibility. Not if we're faithful to the church in service, and we must be, because I talked about worship. Not even if we're faithful in giving our finances, and we must do that because God's called us. But we must love one another, and then God will know that we truly love Him, and others will know that we are Christians by our love. I shared this once more, but I'm going to do it again. The Bible talks so much about one another. You see, you're a family. You're a body of Christ. You're brothers and sisters in Christ. And the Bible talks so much about one another. We're one. We are in the body. We're one another. We love one another. Romans 12, 16, live in harmony with one another. Romans 13, 8, love each other. Romans 15, 7, welcome one another. Romans 15, 14, instruct one another. Romans 16, 16, greet one another. Galatians 5, 13, serve one another. Ephesians 4, 32, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another. Ephesians 5, 19, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Ephesians 5:21, submitting to one another. Colossians 3:16, teaching, admonishing one another in all wisdom. Hebrews 3:13, exhorting one another. Hebrews 10:24, stir up one another. Hebrews 10:25, encourage one another. And finally, 1 Peter 4:9, show hospitality to one another without grumbling. We are to love and care for one another. That's the body of Christ. That's when a church is doing that, it's healthy. It will be flourishing. Right now, I sense you people are loving one another. You're beginning to flourish. Keep that going. May God grant that accelerate. May God grant that continue. May God grant that it grow. That you love one another. That you care for one another. You have concern for one another. To His praise and glory. Amen?
Amen.
And then number six, the church is marked with a commitment to build strong families. You know, the communists, the socialists want to destroy the nuclear family because they know how powerful that is. So they're trying to destroy it. I've said this before, we already know, our country is under an assault. It's under an assault. The hard woke left is determined to destroy this country. And when they tear down the family, then they have a basis to continue to destroy the country. And we need to build strong families. In our Baptist Faith and Message, it said it so well, I'm just going to read this to you. God has ordained the family as the foundational institution of human society. It is composed of persons related to one another by marriage, blood, or adoption. Marriage is uniting one man and one woman. I want to emphasize that. One man and one woman in covenant commitment for lifetime. It is God's unique gift to reveal the union between Christ and His church and to provide for the man and the woman in marriage, the framework for intimate companionship, the channel for sexual expression according to biblical standards, and the means for procreation of the human race. The husband and wife are equal, of equal worth before God, since both are created in God's image. The marriage relationship models the way God relates to His people. A husband is to love his wife as Christ loves the church. He has the God-given responsibility to provide for, to protect, and to lead the family leadership. A wife is to submit herself graciously to the servant leadership of her husband, even as the church willingly submits to the leadership of headship of Christ. She being in the image of God as is her husband and thus equal to him has God-given responsibilities to respect her husband and to serve as his helper in managing the household and nurturing the next generation. Children, from the moment of conception, and by the way, I believe that life begins at conception. Amen? Thank God for those that love the Lord and have those beautiful children that are being born. At conception are a blessing and a heritage from the Lord. Parents are to demonstrate to their children God's pattern for marriage. Parents are to teach their children spiritual and moral values that lead them through consistent lifestyle, equal and loving discipline to make choices based on biblical truth. Children are to honor and obey their parents. Wow. That's what we need to build in the churches. And the more that we build those kind of strong families, the stronger the church will be to the glory of God. The edifying, strengthening, and enabling of the home. Number seven, a healthy church is marked by a wholesome evangelistic outreach ministry. We all know, and we should, Matthew chapter 28, verses 16-20. Let me read it. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him. But some doubted. So they began with worship. Jesus came and said, "All authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am always with you, even to the end of the age." Now let me just share a few thoughts as we come to the closing. In the Greek language, when Jesus said go, it's a participle. A participle is a verbal adjective, usually ending in ing, running, walking, playing. So here's how it can literally be translated. As you are going. Now he's saying this to the church. As you are going. He's already believing and understanding that the church is already about going to, and here's the imperative, two words, make disciples.
Yes.
Make disciples. Now, what is a disciple? A disciple is a believer and a follower and a learner of Jesus Christ all of their life. If you're a disciple and you're here this morning, so you give evidence you are. You are one who has trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. You have been transformed. He has changed your heart and your life. You now have been adopted into His family. You've been forgiven of all your sins, past, present, future. You are now adopted into His family. You are a child of God. You're a saint. You are saved. You are born again. You are a believer. And you are a follower of Jesus Christ. And you are a teacher, a learner of all that He taught us to do. You are a disciple when you fulfill what I'm saying about those characteristics. And Jesus said, you are to go and make disciples of all nations. This is what Dr. Earl Rademacher, who was president of the Conservative Baptist Seminary in Portland, Oregon, years ago, said. He said, the church is the agency of God to transact His business in the world. The church is the agency of God to transact His business in the world. And what is God's business? It is the salvation and transformation of life. It is the changing of lost people to saved people. It is people coming to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and becoming His disciple and living for Him and walking with Him until they die and go to be with Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen and amen. You are the body of Christ. Now, I close, this is my second closing, but I close with this. Everything I said, all seven of those are determined on one thing. I didn't put it as an outline because I want you to understand. Everything that I said has to be empowered by the third person of the Blessed Trinity, the Holy Spirit of God. He is the one that helps us to have celebrative worship. He is the one that enables us to hear biblical preaching. He is the one that can develop leadership in the church. He is the one that can help us to have an effective ministry. He is the one that can help us to love and care for one another. He is the one that helps us to build strong families. And He is the one that helps us in outreach and making disciples. Brothers and sisters, this is what a healthy church is. And may God grant that you will continue in this road of healthy church. Would you stand? Every head. bowed, every eye closed, if you'll just stand right now. I want everyone here, just right now, in the quietness of your heart, where you're standing, where you're starting to pray, that you'll just say, Lord, I pray, dear God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you will take these principles and continue to strengthen every one of them in our church. Father, we look to you through your Son, Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Build these principles deeper and deeper into our church through the power and the work of the Holy Spirit of God who is present. Father, I thank you for biblical truth. I thank you for the Lord Jesus, our Savior and our Lord. I thank you for the Holy Spirit who lives in us and can empower us and direct our lives. I thank you, God, for Memorial Baptist Church. I thank you, God, that there's a sense of healing and fellowship and love that is developing in this body. Dear God, may it continue. May they continue to be the people of God and flourish because the church is healthy. Keep it healthy, Lord. Help it to be even more healthy and flourish to the praise and glory of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen.